Exodus chapter 15. We're going to be thinking about the song, what's called the Song of Moses. But we're going to start by looking at Exodus chapter 14 and verse 30, just to remind ourselves of the context, the background to this song. And it is, of course, that the children of Israel have crossed the Red Sea. And as they've crossed, then God caused the sea to come back again. And the Egyptian army and Pharaoh that were following after them have been killed. So let's read from Exodus chapter 14 and verse 30. And we'll move down into chapter 15 and end at verse 21. Let's hear the word of God. So the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. So the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has cast into the sea. He has chosen captains, also drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank to the bottom like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, has become glorious in power. Your right hand, O Lord, has dashed the enemies in pieces. And in the greatness of your excellence, you have overthrown those who rose against you. You sent forth your wrath. It consumed them like stubble. And with the blast of your nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright like a heap. The depths congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy said, I will pursue. I will overtake. I will divide the spoil. My desire shall be satisfied on them. I will draw my sword. My hand shall destroy them. You blew with your wind. The sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? You stretched out your right hand. The earth swallowed them. You, in your mercy, have led forth the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them in your strength to your holy habitation. The people will hear and be afraid. Sorrow will take hold of the inhabitants of Philistia. Then the chiefs of Edom will be dismayed. The mighty men of Moab, trembling, will take hold of them. All the inhabitants of Canaan will melt away. Fear and dread will fall on them. By the greatness of your arm, they will be as still as a stone. Till your people pass over, O Lord, till the people pass over whom you have purchased, you will bring them in and plant them in the mountain of your inheritance, in the place, O Lord, which you have made for you, for your own dwelling, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. For the horses of Pharaoh went with his chariots and his horsemen into the sea, and the Lord brought back the waters of the sea upon them. But the children of Israel went on dry land in the midst of the sea. Then Miriam, the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took the timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances. And Miriam answered them, sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its riders, this rider, he has thrown into the sea. Well, may the Lord add his blessing to that portion, that reading from God's word. Let's, before we come to look at that section of God's word, let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, as we come and give you praise for the way that, as we've seen, Lord, over some weeks now, you have been a mighty God and dealing with the forces of evil that had enslaved your people. And you have delivered them from Pharaoh and from his army. You enabled them, Lord, to walk on that dry land between the two walls of water that you had formed in the Red Sea. We praise you and thank you that you are a God of wonder, a mighty God, that we can declare that you are our salvation like Moses of old, that you are our strength and our song. And Lord, we ask and pray this morning that as we come to this word, your word, oh Lord, do our souls good. Help us to be reminded again how great you are, what a wonderful God you are. And Lord, open our hearts, open our minds to receive from you, and that we might know a great encouragement from you, and that we might know you as our great God, and the Lord Jesus Christ himself as our great Savior, and Lord and Redeemer. And Father, we pray these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to be thinking this morning about this, what's often described as the Song of Moses. But before we actually look at the Song of Moses, let me introduce you to a man called William Williams. William Williams, and there's lots of William Williamses in Wales, so you have to put in brackets the way he came from. And he came from the farm of Pantycelyn. So we often refer to him as William Williams Pantycelyn, and unfortunately for lots of people, there are several hymn writers called William Williams, so you have to discern when they died in order to discern which William Williams we're talking about. But this one was a famous Welsh preacher. He was born in 1717 and died in 1791. So he's in that sort of what we would describe as the 18th century. And that was a time of great revival. There were great preachers in Wales at that time, great movement of God in Wales at that time. There were preachers like, perhaps you heard of Daniel Rowlands and Howell Harris. Well, if you put those two as the two main preachers, William Williams would have probably be third in that list. He was a great hymn writer. It's said of him that he wrote 1,000 hymns. I had an American pastor contact me on an email once and wanted to know if I could translate some of the hymns of William Williams into Welsh. And I wrote back and said, "You must be joking." A, I didn't have, my Welsh wasn't good enough. And B, there were so many, it would take me a lifetime to do it. And nobody, as far as I know, has actually translated all the hymns of William Williams into English. But he also wrote some English hymns, and we know them. And of course, there's been a lot of translations, like the one we've just sung, "Jesus, Jesus, All Sufficient," as well. And of course, the one perhaps you do know is "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah," which he himself translated from the Welsh into English, though it's credited to a man called Peter Williams. There's some debate whether Peter Williams actually has given us the translation. I'm going too far now. I'm going off on a tangent. But anyway, William Williams is a great hymn writer, okay? But there was something that was rather unique about William Williams. He was one of these people who had a kind of mind that would often was good at poetry. And I read a story about something that William Williams did. But I gather from what other church historians have told me, this is something he could do quite often. But what I read was this. He went to a church and he preached, and he was looking through the hymn book for the last hymn. He wanted to find a hymn that sort of matched what he was preaching on, and he couldn't find it. Couldn't find a hymn. So what he did, there and then, even as he was preaching, he was working out a hymn. And so when he finished his message, he taught the people the hymn. He even worked out the tune that would go to the hymn. And what he did was he announced the first two lines of the hymn, And he would sing it to the people, and then they would have to sing back to him those first two lines. And then he'd work to the next two lines of the hymn that was in his brain, and they would sing the lines back. Well, that's probably one reason why he ended up with 1,000 hymns, because somebody was writing it all down. But by the end of the service, the people had learned a new hymn of William Williams, but they also learned a great deal of theology, because one of the things about William Williams's hymns is that they're packed full of theology. And he was teaching the people of Wales, not only through his preaching ministry, but through his hymns, the great theology of the scriptures. Now, why am I saying that? Well, we're going to be looking at this song of Moses. And I think Moses probably did something similar as William Williams. There on the banks of the Red Sea, as they realized that God in his mercy and in his wonderful providence has taken the people of Israel across the Red Sea, there on the other side now of the sea, and they're looking back and they sing the song. Now, looking at this and looking at some of the commentators, they tell us that in the Hebrew that's being used gives the impression that Moses is, and the way they refer to it, that Moses is the conductor of the choir. So when you get to verse 1 of Exodus, obviously didn't put that verse in, never mind. There we are, verse 1. We read that Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord. And the way that structure, the Hebrew structure there, apparently that Moses was leading the singing. So perhaps because Moses is a prophet, isn't he? He's got these words that God has given him, and he's giving these words of scripture which they're singing. The song, "I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously." And you can imagine how Moses is kind of singing this, or perhaps he's proclaiming it, and then the people are returning the words back to Moses, and they're worshiping God in this way, just like William Williams would have done to a congregation. Well, let's go to our first point. And the first point is this, and I don't know if you ever, the first point is this, that this is the first psalm in the Bible. I wonder if you ever thought about that. You know, you go to the book of Psalms and you think, oh, yes, there's all those psalms, they've all been collected together. But actually, if you think about it, this is the very first psalm in the Bible. And it's the psalm that was, should we put it like this, composed by Moses, given to Moses by God, I'm sure. And the Hebrew scholars tell me that the Hebrew in this particular song is quite difficult, because it is very ancient. If you read, we read Isaiah in our communion service, if you read Isaiah, his Hebrew is comparatively modern compared to the song of Moses here. It's a very ancient Hebrew language. The words are very different and have changed over the centuries as well. So it's a very old and ancient form. Even those who are not Christians and who study Hebrew acknowledge this is a very old portion of Scripture. And it's a psalm in three parts. And each section starts with praise to God. So Exodus chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, "I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him." And those three parts start off with praise to God and glory, giving glory to God. And the three sections are these, verses 1 to 5. verses 6 to 10 and verses 11 to 17. And throughout those sections, we start off with praise to God, and then there's a declaration of God's victory over his enemies and his people's enemies. But there's a problem. And the problem is with the 21st century human being, 21st century man and woman, because we have a certain sensitivities. I was imagining as I was preparing this message, somebody saying something like this to me. You know, this song can seem to be so harsh. This song seems to be so unloving, so cruel. I mean, how can you sing a song about dead bodies on the beach of the Red Sea? But we need to remind ourselves the reality, as we've been looking over these weeks, the reality of the sufferings of the people of Israel in Egypt, the cruelty of the Egyptians, the cruelty of the Pharaoh that enslaved the people. And I think what we got here is that the people of Israel, they're there on the seashore, and they're seeing their enemies, the dead bodies of their enemies. But the reality for them is this. They thought they were going to be the dead bodies on the seashore. They thought that the Egyptian Pharaoh and his army would decimate them. But God had delivered them. And so their hearts are full of praise to God. This is what God has done. We couldn't stand. We couldn't fight against this army of Egypt. But God had delivered them. And it's God who we discovered last time, who fights for them. It's God who delivers them as their champion. And you see something of this in verses 3 to 5. In fact, we go through the whole of this psalm and we see the same themes coming through. But this verse, Exodus 15, verse 3 and 5, the Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has cast into the sea. His chosen captains are also drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank to the bottom like a stone. It's quite graphic in many ways, isn't it? And you can picture what's going on. They are God's people, the people of Israel. And this was God's battle against us. We've noticed when we're working through our way through the plagues, this was God's battle against the devil and the devil's forces. This wasn't just simply a battle between two people groups, but it was between the holy God and the evils of Satan. Well, we could spend a long time looking at this psalm. But you might be glad to know that we're not going to spend a long time looking at this psalm, probably just two Sundays. But we're going to start at Exodus 15 and verse 11 to 13. And there in that section, it poses the question, who is like you, O Lord? It's part of their song. It's a rhetorical question. They know what the answer is. And we're going to hear their answer this morning. Who is like you, O Lord? And I'm going to be looking at these verses, these just three verses of this psalm this morning. We're going to look at a few more verses next time. But these three verses, Exodus 15 and verses 11 to 13. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? You stretched out your right hand, the earth swallowed them. You, in your mercy, have led forth the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them in your strength to your holy habitation. Now, we're not going to spend a great deal of time looking at those words, but as we spoke about William Williams and how William Williams, through his hymns, was also teaching the people theology, the teachings of the Bible. So we discover that in this psalm, the people are singing theology. They're singing the doctrines of God. They're singing their belief in God. So we're going to be looking at Some of the teachings that we find in even in that small portion of that psalm. And the first is this. God is the only God. God the only God. Where we read there in verse 11, who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? What Moses and the people of Israel are declaring, what Moses and the people of Israel are singing, is that there is only one God. And that God is, well, the old name used to be Jehovah. Yahweh is the name that the theologians describe the name of God these days. And perhaps we need to just bear that in mind because of the background of these people of Israel, the children of Israel. They had been living for something like 400 years in the land of Egypt. And Egypt and its pharaohs were obsessed with different gods. Even today, you can go on your holiday into Egypt, you can go and see the Valley of the Kings and the pyramids, and you get struck by how many gods there were in Egypt. And yet, these people who were there, immersed in that culture, immersed in those gods, here they are singing, having been taken out by God out of Egypt. Here they are singing that there is only one God. In fact, if you want to put it like this, over the centuries until the time of Jesus, there was only one group of people in the whole world who would declare a teaching that there is only one God. Because all the other nations, the Romans, the Greeks, whoever you wanted to think of in terms of empires, the Macedonians and so on like that, they all believed in different gods. The Egyptians were exactly the same. And those plagues that we were looking at were, each of them had a connection with some Egyptian god or other, didn't they? And how God defeated these Egyptian gods who were no gods at all. And Pharaoh thought of himself as a semi-god, a demigod. And that somehow the idea was that when Pharaoh was died and he was given all his ceremonies and he had all his grave goods, he would be taken off into some distant land of the dead and he would become a god. And there the children of Israel, they're looking at the bodies of these Egyptians. Perhaps they've even seen the body of Pharaoh, this man who thought of himself as being godlike, and he's dead. All the other gods are false gods. The God of Israel is the one true God who does, as verse 11 tells us, mighty things. So by way of application, let me say this really. There is only one God, and there is only one Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you remember how Peter expressed that thought, that teaching to the Jewish leaders? Acts chapter 4, verse 12, he was before the Sanhedrin, and he said, there's only one name in heaven given to men by which we must be saved, and that was Jesus. And the children of Israel here are declaring the same thing. There's only one God and one salvation. And that is through the God of Israel. Now, in making that declaration, what we're saying this morning is this. All other gods of all other religions are false. If people do not believe in Jesus, then even if they say they're religious, even if they say that they've got some sort of spirituality, they're worshipping false gods. They're worshipping the gods of their own imagination, their own gods of their own concept. And the reality of these false gods will be revealed when Christ comes again, when he gathers his people together himself and brings that judgment down upon earth. But there's a second thing that we can read in these verses, of verses 11 to 13, and it's this, that God is holy. He's a holy God. God's holiness makes him glorious. God's holiness makes God glorious. Do we seek to bring glory to God? Do we seek to give God the praise and the blessing? Then we need to be ourselves, if we know and trust the Lord Jesus Christ, we need to know ourselves to be a people that seek after holiness, seek after righteousness, turning our way from the things of this world and from the ways of sin. Let me quote to you 1 Peter and chapter 1 and verse 15. And Peter himself is actually quoting from Leviticus chapter 11. But Peter says in his letter, his general epistle to the churches, "But as he who called you is holy," we worship a holy God, don't we? "You also be holy in all your conduct, in all that you do, in word and in deed, because it is written, 'Be holy, for I am holy.'" A third thing that we get from those verses 11 to 13, is this, that God has God's mighty act, what God has done. Let's read verse 12. That tells us something of it. "You stretched out your right hand, the earth swallowed them." You know, the seas came, the walls of the seas came back down upon the Pharaoh and upon his chariots and upon his army. God did a mighty act at the Red Sea, didn't he? He demonstrated his power. He was able to divide the Red Sea. A wall of water on the right, a wall of water on the left. And so many of the Psalms you read in the book of Psalms go back to those days. Praises God for what he did at the Red Sea, how he took his people out of Egypt and how they crossed the Red Sea. But I want to say this. The crossing of the Red Sea, the division of the Red Sea, the rescuing of his people out of Egypt and to take them into the promised land is as nothing in comparison to what was done at Calvary. It was a mighty act, this Red Sea, but Calvary is a mightier act, because at Calvary, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior, rescued the perishing. He rescued us. He took the sins, our sins, upon himself and died upon that cross. At the Red Sea, we see something of God's judgment upon evil and upon the devil and the personification of the devil, which was Pharaoh and his army. And Pharaoh, despite the many genuine signs, I mean, spoke about this some weeks ago, didn't we, about the genuine signs of God's power, and even Pharaoh's declaring of it, was not enough for Pharaoh. He continued to blaspheme and continued to sin. But at the cross, we see something more. We see the love, we see the grace, we see the mercy of God in sending his only begotten Son to die in our place, to send his Son to turn away sin from us, dealing with sin in us, and took that sin upon himself. Let me quote to you Romans chapter 5 and verse 8. "But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Well, one final thing to mention from those verses 11 to 13, before we close, is this. And that is, we've seen God's been the only God. God is holy, God's mighty act, but then there's God's promise. And we're going to be thinking more about this next time. But God's promise to Moses and to Israel was of his promise of guiding them, and we should say this as well, guarding them to the promised land. God had led them thus far. He had taken them out of Egypt. He had enabled them to cross on dry land through the Red Sea. And now he was going to take them to that promised land, the land that was promised to Abraham and to the fathers who were the fathers of the children of Israel. But what God is promising in verse 13 is not simply Mount Sinai, where Moses was to receive the Ten Commandments, but actually Mount Zion, where they were going to build a temple and where they were going to worship God and where the Lord Jesus Christ one day would enter and preach. There we read in Exodus 15, verse 13, "You in your mercy have led forth the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them in your strength to your holy habitation." That's something that God is going to do for all of his people. He will take us, he will preserve us, he will lead us, he will guide us, not to Jerusalem, not to a temple, but to the heavenly Jerusalem, to heaven itself. As God promises to preserve and to guide his people Israel, so God promises to preserve and to guide all his children who believe in Jesus. If we belong to Jesus, then the Lord truly is our shepherd. And the good shepherd is Jesus, who laid down his life for the sheep. John chapter 10, verse 14 to 16. "I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd." One final application point. Sometimes, even as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we can begin to doubt, can't we? We can begin to doubt the tender keeping care of Jesus, the Good Shepherd. We can sometimes doubt because of something we may have done or some unbelief that's come into our heart. And we can begin to doubt whether God really will have me. We might have said, well, I've proclaimed the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. I know Jesus as my Savior. But, you know, I've let him down so many times. There's perhaps one sin that has come into my life, and I feel something going to be, God would cast me off. I wouldn't want me to be in heaven, you might say. But if you doubt this morning, if you know and love the Lord Jesus Christ, but yet there are doubts, perhaps if there's a lack of assurance that you are a Christian this morning, let me just take you to the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. Once more in John chapter 10, but these words from verse 27 and verse 30. "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life." Your eternal life is not because of who you are or what you've done. Your eternal life is because of Jesus and what he has done. "And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." Once you know the Lord Jesus Christ to be your Savior and your Lord, you're in the hand of Jesus, but more than that, you're going to be in the hand of the Father as well. Verse 30 to verse 29. "My Father in my hand." Let's start with verse 28 again. "Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we give you praise and we give you thanks. We who know and love the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord, we thank you for these words of Jesus as we've closed this morning. Words that remind us again that we're in the hands of Jesus. And no one can snatch us out of his hand or your hand. And that what you have begun in our lives, you will continue to that time when you will call us to be with yourself in heaven. And just as we've seen, Lord, how the children of Israel were led out of Egypt and through the Red Sea and into and will go into a promised land. So we praise you and thank you that your people are being led by you, being protected by you, being guided by you, being guarded by you. And coming to that time when you will gather your people together, so that we will be gathered at the marriage supper of the Lamb, that there in eternity we will be forever worshipping you and our precious Savior, Redeemer, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.